The ideas expressed in the following presentations are those of the speakers and do not necessarily reflect the views of ACI or its committees. ACI web sessions are recorded at ACI conventions or other concrete industry events and will be made available for viewing free of charge for 1 week. Thereafter, they will be archived on the ACI website or added to ACI's online CEU program, depending on their content.
Thank you so much to Professor Cheng and to Professor Kim to give me the opportunity to have this presentation here. The presentation is about solid structure interaction and the semi-static loads in unintegral Wellman bridges. Well, we choose semi-static loads because the problem of solid structure interactions is simplified, as we have seen in the other presentations with dynamic loads is much more complicated. So we need to start from some point to develop my research in Fuji University. My presentation is divided in four parts: an introduction, a state of art, numerical model, and results of conclusions. Well, let's start with a definition of what's an integral Wellman bridge. And an integral Wellman bridge is a bridge with a monolithic connection from the superstructure into the infrastructure. So usually, the infrastructure should be flexible enough to accommodate the horizontal displacement caused by the expansion and contraction on the deck. Well, simple supported bridges, we have many problems related to durability that with integral Wellman bridges we can avoid. For example, the bearing supports that are not on the initial position on time by the constant expansion and contraction of the deck. So in time, we need to replace them or to reaccommodate them. The water that goes inside the expansion joints causes a deterioration of the end of the girders, of the steel reinforcement, anchor blocks, and so on. And on this case, there is also a deterioration of the infrastructure. On the last picture that I'm showing you here, there are some solid materials that go inside the expansion joints and block the free expansion of the bridge. Well, this is a project of my country where we check that by the change of bridges with simple supported scheme into integral Wellman bridge, we can have a reduction of 10% of the initial cost, considering that the foundation on these bridges, as you can see here, are really high, so we can increase a little bit the span of the bridge and change the typology of the foundations into piles. Unfortunately, by the lack of acknowledgement about this type of bridges, the administration in charge reject our proposal. Talking about maintenance, this is another road in my country. The name is Cotapata Santa Barbara, that goes from 5,000 meters to 1,000 meters in 120 kilometers. So we have a lot of bridges, as you can see here, because it's a mountainous road. 120 bridges, so you can estimate more or less 300 expansion joints, and the number of bearings that we have there is also really high. And with 15 years of service life, these devices are starting to present problems related to durability that we presented before. And the replacement of these devices is more or less 10% of the initial cost of the bridge. Considering that these devices has a service life of only 20 years and the total service life of the bridge is 100 years, if we build or if we retrofit them into integral Wellman bridges, we can save a considerable amount of money also in the maintenance. Well, what's the difference between the behavior of a simple supported bridge and an integral Wellman bridge? On a simple supported bridge, we have these elements that isolates the superstructure and the infrastructure, the bearings and expansion joints. So we can also design the superstructure and infrastructure separately. On the case of an integral Wellman bridge, we are going to have a rigid connection between the superstructure and the infrastructure. So by the displacement on the deck, the soil behind the infrastructure is going to introduce some stresses into the structure. What are the variables added on an integral Wellman bridge and not so significant in a simple supported bridge are the temperature, as we say before, creep and shrinkage that are going to cause contraction of the deck, and also a redistribution of stresses because, as we can see here, some loads are applied on a static scheme that is simple supported, and we performed a rigid connection between the superstructure and the infrastructure. And by the compatibility bending moment that is generated on this section by the constant deformation by creep on the superstructure, we are going to reduce the bending moment at the middle span and to increase the bending moment near the supports. Well, and soil stiffness that depends on the stiffness of the soil that we are going to have behind the abutment, we are going to have a different response on the structure, especially on the foundations. To end the introduction, I want to introduce some advantages and concerns about interalbumin bridges on China and also my country. Well, the advantages are, of course, the elimination of expansion joints, the elimination of bearings, improve the surface quality. On the case of these mountainous roads on my country with more than 300 expansion joints, most part of them doesn't have a good maintenance, so you can feel it every 30 seconds, which is not very comfortable for the users of the road. Prevention of corrosion of the superstructure and injuries by the run of water, and lower construction and maintenance costs that I have shown you with two projects in my country, and I know that on USA you have certain surveys that show similar results. Well, and what are the concerns? Lack of a specific national code. Well, in China they have codes about bridges, well developed and so on, but nothing specific to interalbumin bridges. For example, they use a linear approach to consider the springs on the foundations. The variety in the methods for the design and construction on USA, we know that you use steel piles. We know that steel piles are much more flexible than concrete piles. But in China, they are using concrete piles. I'm going to show you some case study with bridges with quite important total length. Uncertainties about the soil structure interaction, as we have seen here before on some other presentations, using different approaches, we are going to have different response of the structure. If it's difficult to predict the elastic modulus of concrete, imagine how difficult it is to predict the behavior of the soil, which is a more heterogeneous material. And uncertainties about the time-dependence properties of concrete, creep and shrinkage that I have shown you that have certain importance on the design of interalbumin bridges, and so on. Here, what I want to present to you is the different approaches that we have studied to consider the soil structure interaction. Well, the first one is to consider with solid elements the soil. Well, these solid elements can be linear, can be nonlinear. We can use some other elements to consider the exact contact between the soil and the pile and so on. And there are some other, which is not practical for the design. There are some other models that are the springs attached to the piles, and some other presentations show us how to develop these and so on. And there is also a third stage of simplification, that is the equivalent cantilever pile, that adds the stiffness of the soil to the stiffness of the pile and give us an equivalent length of the pile. And some variation of this method could be the equivalent pile with some springs attached into the base. Vertical springs, horizontal springs, and rotational springs. The approach that I showed you before, it is presented on a Spanish document, La Guía de Cimentaciones de Carretera, where they use this approach to calculate the stresses caused by horizontal displacement on piles. This depends if it's sand on the stiffness of the soil, and if it's clay on the undrained shear strain. And from there, we can calculate an equivalent length and the equivalent springs attached on the base. There are some other approaches to calculate this equivalent cantilever, one that is quite famous, proposed by Abendroth and Grayman in 1989, that give us different curves to calculate this equivalent cantilever length related to the boundary conditions that we are going to have at the top of the pile, if it's a fixed head condition or if it's a pin head condition. And this approach gives us three equivalent cantilever lengths, one for buckling, one for bending moment, and one for horizontal stiffness. It is true that most part of these approaches are focused on steel piles. Well, if the problem is simplified with an equivalent cantilever length, we can isolate the structure and we can simplify the problem to check what's the bending moment caused by the horizontal displacement. And as we can see here, it's nothing more than the stiffness of the pile divided by the equivalent length multiplied by a coefficient that depends on the boundary condition at the top of the pile and multiply by the horizontal displacement that we are going to introduce into our pile. In the case of a partial fixity, we need to calculate this K element that gives us the partial restraint at the top of the pile. So from here, what we need to verify is if the initial stiffness is flexible enough to carry out the horizontal displacement, or on the other case, if with an initial force, which is the stiffness that can give us certain relief of stresses and our structure is going to work. Talking about PA curves, they are PA curves for the soil behind the abutments. They are also PA curves around the piles. And there are many people that develop these PA curves doing lab tests and so on. But the parameters in general to calculate them are more or less the same. The density of the soil, the height of the abutment, on the case of the abutment, the angle of friction, the passing and the active pressure, and so on. Talking about the PA curves for the soil around the piles, well, we need some other parameters. It's a little more complicated than for the soil behind the abutment. Well, for our case study, we choose two of these PA curves. One is proposed by Terzaghi and is a linear analysis, a quite old approach, 1943, and the PA curves of the American Petroleum Institute that are the most used on the evaluation of integral abutment bridges. What I wanted to show you here is also with the Chinese code, more or less what's the relationship between the total span of the bridge and the expansion on the abutments. Maybe this is a little different from where you have on Ashto, but more or less we're going to have the same values. And as we can see here, for a display, for a bridge of a total length of 40 meters, we are going to have an expansion of the abutment of more or less 7 millimeters. And if we go back to our PA curves, it doesn't matter if it's a clay or if it's sand with a medium density, we are going to see that the behavior of the soil starts to become nonlinear from this point. So the use of the simplification of the cantilever piles for bridges more than 40 to 60 meters is not quite convenient on this case because this doesn't capture the nonlinear stage of the soil behind them. From 2012 to 2014, 16 integral abutment bridges were built in China. All of them were designed and constructed under the supervision of CIBRIC, that is the research group where I work on Fuzhou University. And China is also really interested to introduce and to upgrade their codes in order to be able to build more reliable integral abutment bridges. We choose the longest integral abutment bridge for our case study in China, that is the Shanbang Bridge on Fujian Province. The total length of this bridge is 120 meters. Considering the two approaches last, we reach 137 meters. We have four spans, so we have three piers. The connection between the piers and the deck is not monolithic. We have bearing supports, but we have a rigid connection between the deck and the abutment. The abutment height is 3.2 meters, and these abutments are supported by four circular concrete piles with a diameter of 0.5 meters and 12.6 meters beneath the abutment. The numerical model that we developed and why we use this bridge is because it was designed from our university, from our research group, so we have a lot of information on the field in order to develop a more reliable and reduce the uncertainties on the model. Our model on SAP 2000 consists of a grillet method with frame elements for the superstructure, also frame elements to model the piers and the piles. To consider the interaction of the structure and the soil, we use spring elements, area spring elements attached to shell elements that represent the abutment, and line spring elements that are attached to the piles. In order to capture the nonlinear stages of the concrete, we use some plastic hinge. We have a potential possibility to develop the nonlinear stage of the concrete and the redistribution of forces. We establish 36 simulations considering different stiffness and densities on the piles, considering the linear approach by Terzaghi and the nonlinear approach proposed by the American Petroleum Institute, and different densities of the soil behind the abutment, and some special cases considering some strategies in order to reduce the stresses on the pile and also on the deck, that are the expanded polystyrene, threaded hole at the top of the pile, and the plastic hinge, while considering moment curvature and the moment rotation of the sections. The stage construction was also developed in our numerical model. The stage construction have four stages. The first stage that consider only the foundation, the second stage that consider the superstructure and the infrastructure without a monolithic connection between of them. The third stage consider this rigid connection, and the fourth stage, consider the increment of deformation by creep and shrinkage from 10,000 days of concrete maturity since the connection of the superstructure and the infrastructure. And from this deformed shape, we apply the other load cases, that are the vehicle case and the temperature case, temperature load. The sections that we calculate and we compare are the bending moment at the middle span of the first span, the axial force and bending moment at the section near the abutment, the displacement of the abutment near the gravity center of the deck, and the bending moment, shear force, and displacement of the pile. From here, what we can see from the dead load case is that the shear force and bending moment doesn't have a high variation if it's a linear analysis or nonlinear analysis.
we are going to have higher values if we use a nonlinear analysis considering all the dead loads. Talking about creep, we are going to have more redistribution near the section of the deck near the abutment with the nonlinear analysis because the soil is more stiff. Talking about the shear and the bending moment, with the linear analysis, we are going to capture higher values than with a nonlinear analysis. Talking about the load case track, the bending moment on the deck is going to be different. If we have a linear analysis, we are going to have more bending moment near the abutment and less bending moment at middle span. If we consider a nonlinear analysis, it's going to be exactly the opposite. We are going to have more bending moment at the middle span than near the abutment. I'm talking about the shear force and bending moment on the piles. The nonlinear analysis are going to be more important on the piles. For the load case temperature, the actual force and bending moment is highly sensitive to the soil behind the abutment. As we can see here, it doesn't matter which analysis we are going to use. And talking about the shear force and bending moment on the piles, because the soil is going to reach the nonlinear stretches, we are going to have more displacement. The shear force and bending moment are going to be more important in a nonlinear analysis. Considering the special cases, the use of expanded polystyrene, pre-drilled hole, plastic hinge, and so on, we are going to have a reduction of the stresses, especially on the bending moment. Be careful when we have a change on the stiffness of the soil because we can have some concentration of stresses, so the shear force is going to be more important. And to end, we develop a sensitive analysis to check the sensitivity for each load case. For the dead load, we can say that the soil stiffness or density is not really important. For time-dependent properties, on this case is really important because the connection that we did on our numerical model was with a quite young concrete. Talking about live load, we can say that we don't have a high sensitivity. And by temperature, the sensitivity to the soil behind and around the piles is quite important. Thank you so much for your attention.